Today, we're really fortunate to have an Olympic champion with us. In fact, so unusual that Stephanie Trafton is the first American woman to win an Olympic gold medal in the discus throw in 76 years. Previous gold medalist was 1936 in the LA Olympics, and Stephanie won in Beijing in 2008. But there's much more to her as well. Her roller derby league and her, no, I'm just kidding. Stephanie was a basketball player in college, but she's also a three-time Olympian in the discus throw and a former American record holder in the discus throw and national champion in the discus and many more things I'm sure that we're going to find out. But I just am so excited to see. It's just an amazing story, and I want to hear what you have to say about these things. And you know, the first question I would ask you, Stephanie, is how did you get attracted, what attracted you to sport and eventually discus? How did you get started in sport?
It's just sports in general, because I was very tall at a young age, and people expected that of me. It was just an expectation that I was going to be good at something. So my dad was a single father. My mom passed away when I was very young. And he knew also that sports was going to give me an outlet and also an input of things and characters that were, you know, character that was going to be built into me based on just participation in sports. He also worked a couple jobs so he needed something after school to kind of, like, you know, childcare, and sports kind of filled that role as well. So from a young age, I was involved in sports, swimming, soccer, volleyball, basketball. What else? I really missed out on softball, though. I never did softball, and I always regretted it. And the only reason I regretted it is because I see the girls on the softball team singing and chanting when they're in the bench area, whatever it's called, the dugout. And I always wanted to be a part of that. I never really kind of got to have that experience with softball. So, I mean, I did have many other great experiences. But so I got started with sports at a young age because I was expected to, basically.
And to continue to engage in it, you had to enjoy it.
And I enjoyed it because it gave me a sense of purpose at the time. The purpose that I had was to be a good student, to be good at sports. It gave me a sense of identity because I was good at it. Now, if I wasn't good at it, I think we'd have a very because I was an athletic ability and I was good at it, you know, I was promoted more and more in the sports itself. And it gave me the sense of that. And I look back on that and think, you know, that's not necessarily the healthiest place to find your self-worth. But that comes from many, many, many years of being in the sport and also self-reflection after the fact.
So others expected you to succeed because you were tall. How tall were you when you graduated high school? Full height?
I think so. I don't think I grew after high school, but my college roster and my high school roster said 6'5", but that's always an exaggeration. I'm about 6'3". And then, of course, if you add an inch for the shoes, 6'4". And I've shrunk a little over the years. I'm barely 6'3", maybe like 6'2½" now.
I think I've lost an inch and a half myself. It happens. Be prepared. So others had that expectation of you, and once you got involved, you started to expect to succeed. How did that play out as a basketball player primarily at Cal State San Luis Obispo?
So when I had a choice of going to college, like originally my dad also thought sports was a very good road to getting a college scholarship, because he was a single father and didn't have any money to spend on college tuition. He had two kids. So not only was it expected of me because I was tall, but I also was expected of me because I needed to get a college scholarship. And I had been told that kind of from the time I was probably like fourth or fifth grade, I was, you know, that going to college was like a promise that my dad had made to my mom before she died. So, but I mean, as a child, I didn't internalize that as an adult would, I think. I never thought that I had like this enormous pressure on me to perform, to get a scholarship. It was never really told to me until later on that was kind of the motivation. So I didn't feel like a pressure that I had to, you know, that I had to get a college scholarship or else I was worth nothing, you know, or else I was letting someone down. Like that wasn't my feeling. The feeling was that I was going to be good at sports because I was tall and because I had shown, you know, that I was pretty athletic at some point or in some respects. And that I needed to get a college scholarship to go to college or else I wouldn't be able to go to college. And that was where my dad was very, you know, encouraging from a young age that college was a ticket to life and to a good life. Higher financial, you know, earning power. And of course the learning that comes with going to college, getting a college graduation or graduating from college. So, it just all was like this big package of, you know, I started off with success and then it built on more success. And some, of course, some failures along the way, but it was never really a failure that was like, this is not going to work out. It was like, this is just another path and another stepping stone to the next level.
Right. Right. So you threw the discus in college as well as basketball. Basketball was your primary sport.
Yeah. And basketball was my scholarship came from basketball.
How did you transition from being a basketball player to I'm a discus thrower and I'm going to go chase the discus? At some point you had to realize, maybe I'm not going to be playing professional basketball. Maybe I should throw the discus. There's much less money involved there. How did that transition take place?
So even when I was like pretty successful at throwing in high school, I went down to the Olympic Training Center in Chula Vista as a high schooler to do a clinic. And even then I was buying the basketball gear from the Olympic, you know, shop. Like it was all about like, I was still in doing the high level track and field and throwing, but I was like envisioning a basketball career. So my scholarship was to play basketball. And I, my first year playing college basketball my first year in college, I didn't even really have to do with basketball as a, you know, very self-revealing experience. And are you hearing that?
Yes. No, right. I hear your voice. I don't hear.
I got to turn my phone on silent. Someone texted me.
I didn't catch the text message noise.
You didn't text me? Okay.
Sorry.
So my first year in college was, of course, formative. Of course, everybody, you know, everybody's first year and a new experience away from home is a very formative experience in terms of like who I am, who I want to be. But my identity as a basketball player was pretty solid, but I started to feel not as, I didn't feel I was in love with the sport as much as I used to be. It was so hard because our team was in a building year, so we weren't winning as much, and I didn't have that, you know, constant, you know, encouragement of a win to kind of to buffer so much of the experiences. So I started to kind of fall out of love with basketball, and I was still doing track and field, but in the off season. And so my sophomore year was the most influential year for me, because the beginning tournament of our basketball of the year was like December, and I tore my ACL in a basketball game. And we were in Florida, and so I was across the country, because my college, of course, is in California. So across the country, it was my birthday. And I had this birthday present of tearing my ACL and being told by the doctor that my season was done, you know, my basketball season. And that, of course, was pretty devastating for my identity, not just physical pain, but like everybody knows me as a basketball player. Like, what am I without basketball?
Right, right.
So, you know, that opened a lot of opportunities for reflection and finding out who I am without basketball. And all, but the thing about it is I had a fallback, and my fallback was throwing discus and shot put. And so it was not a very hard fall, as you could imagine. I mean, being a standout in my track and field, you know, program, my identity switched over from being a basketball player to now I'm going to be the best discus thrower and shot putter there is at my school. And that wasn't a very hard fall, just put it that way.
Uh-huh. So you were done with basketball then your sophomore year?
Yeah. So at that point I had decided that I was not in love with basketball anymore. And that, after my ACL tear, I had a real kind of crossroads moment where I was like, do I want to continue to play basketball or do I want to go throw discus all, you know, full time student, of course. And so I made the decision to be a full time thrower at that point in terms of my sports career, and continue to use all of the character traits that I had built in basketball on the track, or, you know, in the ring.
Right, right. So pretty easy answer to the question, how did you stop competing? When it comes to basketball, you were forced to stop because of an injury. But let's move forward a little bit. Out of college, you're a discus thrower. How do you keep yourself going as a discus thrower? Out of college, you don't have a scholarship to cover your room and board and things like that. And what kept you at discus? When you graduated from college, you were, where were you? Would you say top 10 in the U.S.? Maybe, maybe not.
Maybe top 15. I actually had an injury my first year out of college. So I kind of dropped off the list altogether, I believe. It was, I believe that I knew my Olympic dream was still there. I wanted to be an Olympian. And this wanting to be an Olympian started when I was 4 years old.
Oh.
And this dream to be an Olympian was centered around being a gymnast, because I watched MaryLou Retton on TV.
Of course.
And I think every little girl in those days wanted to be MaryLou Retton with sparkly, you know, USA leotard on.
Right.
And so Wheaties did a great job of promoting MaryLou Retton, you know, all of the sponsors, and she was on, you know, commercials and cereal boxes, of course, and whatever. So I wanted to be MaryLou and go to the Olympics. So this kind of inspired me to be an Olympian from a very young age. I wanted to wear the USA uniform and do that. But in my brain, it was all about basketball. Like, I wanted to be on the basketball team. So I was going to wear the USA basketball jersey. So going to just being able to transition to another sport, I was still going to go to the Olympics. So that was kind of that dream continued on in a different way. So going from the college rankings to not having any support, but I was still kind of in the mix with USA Track and Field development. They had an eye on me and were able to support me in some ways, but not, you know, not all of the ways that are needed to kind of bridge the gap between college and the next level. So what my dad did, again, here comes dad into the picture. My dad said, well, if you want to make the Olympic team, I need you to write me a business plan on how you're going to make the Olympic team. Because I had taken entrepreneurship classes. I was an engineering student and had graduated from Cal Poly as an engineering student. And I really liked the idea of project management and entrepreneurship and starting something from the ground up and like designing a program. So he design this program, how you're going to make the Olympic team. And if you do that, I'll let you move back into the house. So you would be able to pay my room and board for me and, you know, take care of me.
Do you still have that document?
Somewhere, I do.
Well, you should not lose that. You should not lose that, ever.
Away. And I have a few boxes that I'm going through currently that I'm trying to organize, and that's one of the things in the boxes. So, yeah.
Good. Yeah, don't lose that. That's amazing.
Price material.
I mean, there were times I felt like I was managing a one-person business.
Yes. And
the promoter and the doctor and the scientist, nutrition, the trainer, the whatever, all those things. But I never wrote it up as a business plan.
Oh, okay. Well, that's
terrific.
The business plan. And I wrote this whole document, you know, with all the supporting documentation needed, and even down to technical footwork. I actually have drawings of where my feet needed to go in the ring in order to, you know, produce enough of the torque and the power and, you know,
right,
to throw far. And so I have these little circles drawn with like little foot marks on it, like this is where my feet need to go. So my dad had the wherewithal and the wisdom to tell me to write a business plan on how I was going to make the Olympic team. And this was in 2003. And then I go to the Olympic trials in 2004 and kind of shock most of the other throwers in the U.S. by coming from top 10. Like I was probably ranked like 9 or 10 to the top 3. And producing the A standard, which you need to have to go to the Olympics. Of course, you have to have the minimum standard. So in one throw, I made top 3 and the standard and made my first Olympic team.
Were you surprised?
I don't think it was surprise is really not the best description of it, but when a plan that you've written and dedicated your life to comes to fruition, and you see the results, the success of that plan, it's not so much as a surprise as it is just elation that it actually all works out.
Like, you knew it could happen.
I knew it could happen. I knew the potential of it. And I knew that I had put the work in and I had a document
to prove it. And the only question was, could you execute at the right time?
Exactly.
That only question.
That was the only question, is could I execute the plan at the right time?
I was there. I saw it. I was surprised, not by the throw or the distance, but by the cartwheel afterwards.
Yeah, that was not part of the document.